The PSE index outperformed peers yesterday, jumping 1.2% to close back above 6,400. Joining us this morning to tell us what's next, Christina Ulang. She is head of equity research at First Metro Investments. Christina, good to see you. Hi.
Hi, good morning, Mimi.
Good. Nice to be back. All right. So, Christina, do you think the BSP's meeting this afternoon is a non-event, non-news event already?
Non-event. Why non-event? It's always important.
Mm-hmm. Well, everybody's pricing in a prudent pause.
For the guidance, I think the market's going to be focusing on the communication, the language that Governor Remolona is going to be saying, and that what indicators is he going to cite. Of course, the consensus is that there will be no hike. It's going to be an extended pause. And I think earlier messaging from the BSP governor was like he was citing the currency as stable and just lost about 2% from the year start, its value versus the US dollar. And it seems to hint that they're comfortable. The BSP seems to be comfortable with the mild volatility in the currency and therefore no need to be very alarmist in terms of the key rate hiking it again. It seems that growth is decelerating. There is some risk there as far as the quarter-on-quarter growth. It's actually negative 0.9%. Although year-on-year, we've seen like 4.3, 4.4. Mm-hmm. It's a big negative surprise. I think growth is going to be at the forefront of the many considerations of the BSP, considering that the BSP is considering that inflation is already downtrendy. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it's going to be a pause. And the market knows it already.
Yeah, but when everyone's expecting a prudent pause for a third consecutive meeting, then you've got the governor saying that he thinks, if needed, we can handle a 6.8% benchmark policy rate from 6.25.
I think he's balancing it all out. He's sounding hawkish. Mm-hmm. He's open to more hikes. But at the same time, he seems to signal that it's not all going to be about the currency. It's just this very openness to all of the optionalities available. But it seems at the moment, they could be very focused on the deceleration of growth, which was very, very negative surprise. And they want to be very careful as far as the second half outlook is concerned.
All right. So let's go over to the markets now. You know, the market has been rocky. It has been edgy lately. Okay. We're down. We seem to be seeing lower lows at this point. Is the most likely move for stocks is to move higher at this point, given how we've been, you know, seeing lower lows? Do you think we are at the bottom?
These new lows and lows, we're not seeing new lows actually. 6,300 has been a very strong support for the currency, and for the PSE. And it always happens, this correction always happens every time there is an upcoming BSP meeting on the key policy rate, also ahead of the Fed. So this is not a new thing actually. It's the usual market reaction to any hints of further tightening, strong data in the economy.
Okay.
And so we have these bouts of profit taking and then a risk off and then risk on. So for now, this is the usual knee-jerk reaction, which is very much divorced from the fundamentals, especially corporate earnings, which we have seen grow like that for the entire 30 company PSE. Our own gathering of data and computation points to like 25% growth first half year on year, although there's a deceleration in the quarter on quarter.
All right. So many nuances in the way we talk about numbers. Let's not forget the earnings season has ended and ghost month has begun. So that could also play into the factor of volumes here. I want to go over some interesting corporate stories now. Actually, disclosures, nothing from there today, not yet at least, because earnings season is almost done. But I saw this question raised by some of the traders in online groups, and someone was asking, is it better to sell your Metropack shares in the market today than sell it up at the tender offer?
Really depends on your view on the your view on the company and your need for cash. Usually you buy now when the price is still low, and then if it is lower, you earn a margin once it is actually tendered. Like just like in Eagle, people were buying and then they were actually given an upside once the tender offer was completed. And so I think it's going to be the same for those who want quick bucks and doesn't care whether they're going to be in infra or exposing it, because there are many alternatives for an infra exposure. And I think once MPI is delisted, I think the better alternative would be somebody who owns MPI, which is no less than the GT Capital Holdings Group.
All right.
Because you want to be exposed to a lot of toll roads and new projects, joint partnership in San Miguel. And I think the best route is to go via GT Capital Holdings.
Ah, all right. So we have to see if the flows will lead to GT Cap. Also, the PSE earlier this week announced SCCP's T+2 settlement cycle going live on August 24. That doesn't have a material impact on us, right?
SCCP would be...
I think it's the settlement cycle. Settlement cycle, T+2. They say it's going live on August 24. So people are just for info, I guess.
Sure.
And then we have this from this morning. DITO CME board has okayed the issuance of 610 million common shares out of unissued authorized capital stock. Just very quickly, your view on DITO CME. This is the telco holding company of Dennis Oy from Davao.
I think it's not going to be any surprise at all if they should be boosting capital or doing something about capital, because they have had years of losses. And I think there's a good reason for them to do some capital restructuring, and then a consideration of how the balance sheet is going to be positioned given the some deficits there, and whether there's going to be more profit accretive activities onwards. If not, they ought to have some defensive balance sheet. And I think recapitalization is going to be an important component of the balance sheet strategy.
No concerns over possible dilution for those who currently have shares? Because just yesterday, we also reported they issued 1.6 billion common shares out of unissued authorized capital stock and sold it for 1 peso per share, 1.6 billion, that's around a 10% stake.
Of course, there's always going to be some worry about dilution and about a reduction in the prices, market prices. And so there's really a need for investor communication. What's really going to push share prices higher, and what's the prospects of the company as far as growth is concerned? Because the industry is very much matured. There's a lot of competition. There are cost pressures and a lot of need to raise funds, which is now being done via sale of the towers, the telco towers.
All right. Speaking of ASEN, I just wanted to share as well. ASEN secured 10 billion pesos in a term loan facility. Do you think it's better that these companies who are expanding tap banks versus sell shares at the capital markets to raise money?
It's hard to do it via share sale now in the market, because we're seeing a lot of weakness in the equities market, and we're also seeing this very good alternative of pref shares coming alive in the market, and then of course, the regular bond issuances. So it's all mostly quasi-debt and debt.
Mm-hmm. All right. Just wanted to bring the opening numbers. We're about 4 minutes into trade for the day. The index is down. Not surprising. Everybody else is down in Asia. The index is down by a third of 1%. 19 points. We're at 63.91. Again, big day. The BSP meets. They announced their decision, rate policy decision, at 3:30. That's after trade today. So we're going to see how markets. But we are pricing in a prudent pause. Christina, I think we are ready for your blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. I think you like this stock.
Yes.
Okay, so what do you have for us?
I think it's valuation-wise, it's just in line or has a bit of a discount versus market. It's a conglomerate, and it has been on the acquisition path expanding the product portfolio, the operating subsidiaries. It's heavily into one very important industry in the country. It's building its exposure in that this is where we have a deficit. The country has a deficit in this industry, and it is supplying, filling the gap in the energy space, and doing its own act in terms of the energy transition, going green, and on top of that, it's also growing the other parts of its businesses, which is like the financial services. It has acquired a franchise, a foreign franchise, retail financial services, and again, growing its food and beverage. It's actually into animal nutrition food, and it's being grown. And this is now just recently concluded the acquisition of an international beverage brand. Mm-hmm. Big surprise. And so
we're
seeing that
this
company is going to be a lot more valuable over time.
All right. So what sort of upside in share price?
Moving a bond float, 17 billion.
Okay, now yes. You're giving it away. But what sort of upside in share price are you seeing for this stock?
It should be like going to the level of the market, being a conglomerate and a proxy to the economy. We've seen the PSEI hit like the long-term mm-hmm. average, like 16 times PE. 15 times PE, that's the market, that's the Philippine Inc., that's the conglomerate, if you're going to, it, one way of looking at it. And so being a conglomerate as it is, it should be like going to that level, PE of like 14 from where it is now, like 10 times or 9 times.
Very cheap.
So hopefully the acquisition works its effects, favorable effects on the P&L onwards.
All right. We're just going to have to wait and see and guess if we can. Thank you very much, Christina. Always a pleasure to speak with you. Thank you for the time.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right. See you soon.